Before I start, I have to make two apologies. First of all, my colleagues from IIC have seen this talk already. This is the same talk as what I presented during a departmental group a few months ago. So, if you want to leave, there's no problem.
No, already out.
Yeah. Okay. And the second is that this has only a loose connection with information theory. The only apology I can give is that it seems to me that information theorists these days are quite addicted to different types of concentration of measure inequalities, and we'll use some of that in the analysis that we will talk about. Okay, so this is about Bayesian sparse signal recovery. And so I'll present some work that we've recently done in this area. This is primarily the work of my PhD student, Saurav Khanna. Here we go. There are three parts to the talk. And the first part is really very basic background on the particular type of sparse signal recovery problems that we are looking at. And the second two parts are some new performance guarantees that we have for Bayesian methods for sparse signal recovery, and some new algorithms inspired by this analysis. So part one, sparse Bayesian learning. So in sparse signal recovery, the basic question we ask is to recover a sparse, big long sparse vector x from noisy compressive measurements. So what you get is y, which is the projection of x onto this matrix, measurement matrix p, and with noise being added. The key thing here is that this vector is of length n, which could be much bigger than m, the number of measurements that are available. So this is an underdetermined system of linear equations. And ordinarily, it has infinitely many solutions. And among those solutions, we are looking for the sparsest solution. That is, the solution that has the least number of non-zero entries. So these three parameters, or these three letters here, are the most important ones, and I'm going to refer to them by letter only. So it's good to remember them. M is the number of measurements, n is the length of this sparse vector, and k is the number of non-zero entries that it has. So in a Bayesian approach to sparse signal recovery, we impose a prior on both the noise as well as the signal. So for the noise, we model it as Gaussian distributed, so this is the density of the noise. And for the sparse vector, we'll assume a parameterized prior, where these parameters gamma I are the variances of the ith component. And so we'll we will consider that the entries of this vector x are in fact independent of each other, and they have a variance gamma I, which is unknown. And therefore, what we're going to try to do is to learn gamma I from the measurements y, and if we end up learning a gamma I to be equal to 0, then the corresponding xi will be actually equal to 0. So in terms of a graphical model, if you are used to that notation, we have a set of gamma i's which generate these xi's, which in turn lead to these yi's through this noise equation. So these gamma i's are a set of non-negative, what are called hyperparameters. And basically, this kind of an extra layer of modeling here has several advantages. One advantage being that if you knew gamma, then p of x, given y gamma is then Gaussian, and so then it's easy to find point estimates. Specifically, if you're familiar with using priors to using different types of priors to recover sparse vectors, you know that you should really be using a Laplacian type of prior, which will lead to an L1 norm minimization type of problem. But here we are assuming a Gaussian prior, and typically if you assume a Gaussian prior, that leads to an L2 norm minimization problem, which will not lead to sparse solutions. But as it will turn out, it's because we assume that these variances are unknown, the resulting vectors that you end up estimating become sparse, and you get sparse estimates. And so once you estimated a gamma and you knew that it is, or if you know gamma and it is sparse, then you will love this Gaussian prior model on x, because the posterior distribution is Gaussian, and we know very well how to handle. We know how to handle Gaussians very well. There are other benefits, like in the process of estimating gamma, you end up averaging over x because you want to find the marginal distribution of gamma given, or the posterior distribution of gamma given y. And this averaging over x can be shown to lead to fewer local minima. And furthermore, when we have considered extensions of this basic measurement model, and in those extensions, this gamma can be used to tie parameters together. And that leads to fewer parameters to estimate, and that can help with recovering these sparse vectors. So basically, as I mentioned, there's this unknown set of hyperparameters gamma that we need to first estimate. And once we have this estimate of gamma, then you can find this posterior distribution P of x given y with the plug-in estimator from this maximum likelihood estimation problem. And this is just Gaussian, this is its mean, and this is its covariance matrix. So for point estimates, for example, this itself is your point estimate, the posterior mean. So then the key question is, how do you estimate this gamma hat? This is the hyperparameter. And the log likelihood function for estimating gamma, this P of y parameterized by gamma, you have to average over the distribution of x. And this is just Gaussian. And this is zero mean. And this is its covariance matrix, sigma squared I plus phi gamma phi transpose. And so then you want to use, if you look at this log likelihood function, the negative log likelihood, this is actually the log likelihood, it looks like this, log depth of this matrix sigma y minus y transpose sigma y inverse times y. The dependence on gamma is sitting inside the sigma y, and therefore this problem is also not easy to solve directly. So you have to use iterative estimators, and expectation maximization is one such procedure which is well suited for this problem. So you start with the log likelihood of the complete data, which is just this thing. It has two terms in it. The first term coming because of the Gaussian model on the noise. The second term coming because of the prior model on your x. And this part, nicely for us, fortunately for us, is independent of gamma. And this is a function of gamma dependency enters only through this. And so in the EM approach, you first compute this thing called the Q function, which is the expected log likelihood, given the gamma estimated in a previous iteration of this algorithm. And this essentially involves computing this posterior distribution, or this distribution of P of x given y gamma of t. It has this form. And this distribution itself is Gaussian. So this is its mean, and this is its covariance matrix. Okay. So once you have the previous gamma, and you can compute this quantity, that gives you the sigma, and this gives you the mean, and this is the posterior distribution. And in the m step, you maximize this Q function using over this gamma. So this is the problem you have to solve. It has a nice simple solution because the dependence on gamma is like this. So there's just a 1 over gamma plus log gamma. So you can simply differentiate it and set it to 0. It's very simple to solve. In fact, the solution is E of xi squared. Okay, so E of xi squared given y gamma t is the solution. And so this is how you update your, this is, yeah, so this is, you take these mu I squared plus sigma I n, stack them and take a diagonal matrix. That is your new gamma matrix. Now, one thing I didn't mention, I probably went a little bit fast over, is that in my model, this gamma here, so these gamma i's, I'm going to stack them diagonally on a matrix and call that capital gamma. So that is my covariance of this entire vector x. So each xi is Gaussian distributed with variance gamma I, and I model them as being independent of each other, and therefore the covariance of the entire vector x is with capital gamma matrix. So that's why I say x is Gaussian, zero mean, and covariance gamma. X has to be independent. Yeah. So in the Bayesian, in the modern Bayesian approach to solving problems, I don't care what the physical meaning of my statistical assumption is. I only care about what is the cost function that arises out of making a certain prior assumption, and how do I optimize that cost function, and does it give me a solution that I'm interested in? can I say interesting things or prove interesting properties about it, about the solution. I don't really care about the physical significance of that assumption. So that's, this is one slide summary of this algorithm that I just described. This algorithm was originally proposed in 2001. So this is a very, very old algorithm, it's well known. And it has these two steps. In the E step, you compute this mu and sigma. And in the N step, you update this gamma. And then you repeat these two steps until some convergence criterion is satisfied. And once that is satisfied, in fact, this expression for mu here is exactly a posterior mean. And therefore, that is an estimate of your sparse vector x. So a lot is known about the convergence of this algorithm. For example, it is guaranteed to converge to a fixed point of the log likelihood function from any initialization. Its global minimum occurs in the sparsest solution if the measurements are noiseless. All local minima occur in sparse solution.
So how do you measure sparsity?
So that is actually not easy to see, and one simple explanation I can give you is that if you look at this matrix sigma y here, this is purely an intuitive explanation, and let me consider when there is no noise, then this is phi gamma phi transpose, right? Then I'm doing this log det of sigma y. And if, so consider that the sigma has n entries in it, but phi gamma phi transpose is an m by m matrix. And suppose I have less than m non-zero entries in gamma, right? Then this becomes rank deficient, and therefore this determinant of this thing will be zero. And the log of that will go to minus infinity. Okay, in other words, it will maximize this likelihood. Right? And so the more number of zeros I can insert into this gamma, the more I will push this towards infinity. And therefore it will encourage this gamma to have lots of zeros in it. Okay? This is just a sort of high level explanation. There's more I can talk about, but I need to rewrite this in many different ways and then see that. So another way is to look at, there is, so you can, you can assume, for example, you can work out the unconditional distribution of x by assuming an inverse gamma prior on this gamma itself. It's a conjugate prior of the Gaussian distribution, and I think. And if you do that, it will turn out that the prior on x is student t. And if you look at the properties of that cost function, again, you find that at its core, what happens is that if you can write the function as y minus px L2 norm square, that is your fit error term, plus some penalty term, which has some concave concavity property, then you can show that such a cost function encourages sparse solutions. And this prior also does that. Okay, so there are many more things known about it has many nice properties, and here's a little empirical example of how it performs. What I've done here is to take a 50 by 100 matrix, generate any sparse vector x naught, compute the measurements, then use some algorithm to solve for x naught, and then declare an error if the mismatch between x and x and the x naught that generated the measurements exceeds a certain threshold. And what's plotted is the probability of error versus the sparsity, that is the number of non-zero entries in x. And this is for the case where the non-zero entries are highly scaled, that is, they come from a truncated Jeffries prior, and so it's nothing like a Gaussian. But in this case, you see that this algorithm inspired by this Gaussian modeling of the sparse vector actually performs much better than L1 and the COSAMP and OMP and all these other very popular algorithms in the literature. Okay, so
In many applications, you also don't have exact sparsity.
Yes.
Compressibly.
Yes.
So what would happen?
So okay, so I'll come to that. Okay. So empirically, it's easy to check what happens with this algorithm. You just have to run some simulations and you can see what happens. Theoretically, actually, that brings me to what I wanted to say about this. I was saving it for a little later. I'll say that right now. The point is that you can see that sparse Bayesian learning seems to offer a much better performance than other very popular algorithms that people have looked at in the compressed sensing area. Then you could ask, why is it that people, why are people still talking about ONP and L1 and variants of L1 and convex relaxation type of methods? And why are they not just looking at Bayesian methods? And the answer is twofold. One is that these EM iterations are generally slow. And for big data type problems where the dimensions are getting large, they become even slower. The second is the lack of performance guarantees. Okay, and for L1 type recovery, you have very nice guarantees where it says that if the matrix P satisfies a certain RIP property, then L1 recovery will give you the, for example, if the phi matrix satisfies a 2kth order RIP property, then it will give you the k-sparse approximation of the sparse vector x with high probability. Right? That kind of results are available. Such type of results were not available for, in fact, this kind of result is not available for these algorithms. It's a Jeffries prior truncated to some big number. Okay, so it's 1 by x prior, 1 by mod x as the prior, but truncated somewhere, and then renormalized. So it's a very heavy tail distribution. Yeah. Just to have a sparse vector which has some entries could be very large and some other entries could be small.
So it's not the same distribution as the used?
Not at all, yes.
And so what is the assumption on K? I mean, you're not assuming RIP?
It's a random matrix. It comes, it has IID Gaussian entries. In this case, it will satisfy RIP with high probability. So now I want to talk about one very important extension of sparse Bayesian learning, or in fact of sparse signal recovery that people have looked at in the literature. And this is called the joint sparse model or multiple measurement vector model. Here we are not faced with one instance of the problem, but rather L instances of the problem, where you are given Y1, Y2 up to YL, which are respectively projections of X1, X2 up to XL on this matrix phi. And so you are asked to recover all these L vectors, and what you are told is that they enjoy a common support. That is, if a particular entry in the first vector is non-zero, the same entry in all the vectors will be non-zero, and if a particular entry is zero, then the same entry in all the vectors will be zero. So they have a common support. So the SBL framework can naturally extend to this kind of a setup. By the way, I must mention that the other methods I talked about also have natural extensions. I'll talk about that a little bit later. But here what we do is we assume that each of these vectors, they're all distributed with a common gamma. And so this common gamma will actually encourage joint sparsity across all these vectors. You learn the same gamma for all L vectors. And I'll also further assume that these vectors x1 to xl are independent of each other. If I do that, basically this is all just the same thing I mentioned earlier, that one can rewrite these EM iterations for this problem, and it turns out that the E step is exactly the same as before, except that it has to be done for each of those L vectors separately, so that's why you have an extra index J floating around. So earlier I had just mu k plus 1 equal to this thing. This also allows for noises to be different at different vectors that you measure, but that's not important. But you have this extra J floating around, but this is exactly what I had before. And the M step basically couples them together and takes the average of this mu j of I square plus sigma j k plus 1 of I comma. So this is the EM iterations for this joint sparse vector recovery problem.
What also happens is some of the samples will be more highly data, they just increase the number.
So here is an interesting plot. What is shown here is what is called the phase transition diagram of sparse signal recovery. This is one way people use to evaluate how well sparse signal recovery algorithms perform. What is shown on the x-axis is the measurement rate, that is the number of measurements divided by the length of the sparse vector. And on the y-axis is the sparsity rate, that is the number of non-zero entries divided by the length of the sparse vector. And the color coding here is that red is a failure and yellow is a success. So basically you can see that if I have very large number of measurements and the sparsity is very low, the algorithm succeeds. On the other hand, if I have very few measurements and the sparsity is high, that means it's a dense vector, then the algorithm fails. And the diagonal line here corresponds to k equal to m, which means that the number of measurements equals the sparsity of the vector. And this plot is the support recovery phase transition. So I'm only asking about whether this algorithm recovers the support of the sparse vector correctly or not. And it's the support recovery phase transition of simultaneous OMP, which is an extension of the orthogonal matching pursuit algorithm to this joint sparse vector recovery problem. And on the right is the support recovery phase transition of the multiple SBL algorithm that I just talked to you about. And you can see that this has far better recovery regime compared to this. And in fact, you can recover more sources than you have equations, right? Even for k greater than m, I'm able to recover the support correctly. Okay. This observation was first made in 2014 by a paper by Balkan and co-authors. Although the MSPL algorithm itself has been known for about 10 years now.
For what values of L?
I think some L equal to 100 or something like that. Not a very huge value of L. So I think L was fixed to be 100 and N was fixed to be 200. And M and K are varied according to the point that you are trying to generate. So as I mentioned, basically this result was known, but there wasn't a good understanding of why is it that this MSBL offers so much better performance than SOMP. And if I were to plot the phase transition diagram for extensions of convex relaxation, that is L1 minimization type algorithms, that would also exhibit a similar phase transition diagram as this plot here, but this is far better. So why is this the case? So that brings me to part two of the talk, which is some new performance guarantees for sparse Bayesian learning that we were able to recently show. So first of all, I'll talk about the L equal to 1 case, that is a single measurement vector problem. And there, so the result is as follows. If the measurements are noiseless, and the result is that the sparse Bayesian learning, it's not the multiple sparse Bayesian learning, I have only one measurement here, this algorithm correctly recovers the support for all k between 1 and spark of this matrix p minus 1. Spark is basically the minimum number of linearly dependent columns in the matrix. Typically, if you choose p with IID Gaussian entries, then spark is m plus 1, so k can go from 1 to m. In contrast, for L1 recovery to succeed, k has to be between 1 and m over log n. So fundamentally, this just gives me an improvement of log n over the L1 recovery. So it's not a very impressive improvement. So now I move on to multiple sparse Bayesian learning. Okay. And here the main result that we are able to show says that if this x1 to xl, so now for my performance guarantees, I'm going to assume that these sparse vectors come from the distribution that I'm using to model these sparse vectors to generate to develop my algorithm. So these x1 to xn have a common support of size k, and the non-zero entries are IID zero mean Gaussian with variance bounded in this interval. They don't have to be all equal, but it's bounded in an interval gamma min to gamma max. So under this condition, the probability that, so let gamma hat be the support returned by the MSBL algorithm. The probability that gamma hat is not equal to the true support S star is something that decays exponentially in the number of NMVs, number of multiple measurements that are available, provided two conditions hold. The first condition is that the self-Khatri-Rao product denoted by phi dot phi should satisfy the restricted isometry property of order 2k. So this is, I think, the one of the major differences between the recovery guarantees we have for multiple sparse Bayesian learning and for L1 type recovery algorithms. There, it's all based on the RIP properties of the matrix phi itself. But now, for this algorithm, what we need is that the phi, Khatri Rao phi, must satisfy an RIP property. So what is phi, Khatri Rao phi? It is the column-wise Kronecker product. So I take the columns of phi one by one, take the Kronecker product of the column with itself, and then write that as an n squared by 1 length vector, and stack this across all the n columns, so I get an m squared by n matrix. That is phi, Khatri Rao phi. And that has to satisfy this property. That is to say that if I take any vector z, which is at most 2k sparse, then its length, when multiplied by phi, by this matrix phi, Khatri Rao phi, the length squared, should not change by more than 1 minus delta and 1 plus delta. This, that factor of the length of the vector z itself. Condition 2 is that the total number of measurements, m times l, okay, should be greater than k squared log n over eta, where eta is given by this formula here. So now notice that this eta here has a 1 minus delta 2k dot sitting here. And so if the self-Khatri Rao product satisfies this RIP property, that means this delta 2k dot is between 0 and 1, then this number is positive. And therefore, this number is positive, and therefore this exponent here is a positive exponent. Okay, it will have a positive decay in terms of L. And the other thing is that in this eta, you see the dependence on gamma min and gamma max, noise variance. And there is also a soup over all sets of size 2k of phi s transpose phi s, the maximum eigenvalue. So it's easy to show that this is very very well behaved because we are looking at the largest eigenvalue, not the smallest eigenvalue, and we are taking the soup over this, so it doesn't grow very fast. Okay, so this is the main result. Okay, so let me maybe make a few comments on. Let's see. Okay. So what I'll do is I'll maybe come back to the outline of the proof later, but basically, okay, maybe not. This is anyway an outline of the proof, so maybe I will tell you a few things about it. So the way it goes is that you write out when this algorithm will make an error. It will make an error whenever, for some gamma in some set other than the correct set, the value of the likelihood function is bigger than the best value within the correct set. The best value of the likelihood function that you can find within the correct set. So theta of s here is the set of all gammas with support s. Okay, that is, the non-zero entries must be between gamma min and gamma max, and the support of that vector must be equal to the set s. And then you apply union bound and replace this maximum by a finite size union over an epsilon net. And then it becomes something like a hypothesis testing problem, and you can use the Sanov type inequality to get a bound like this, where this d half is the 1 half alpha Reni divergence between two hypothesized distributions. And in fact, d half is the same as the Bhattacharya distance, which is what came up earlier today a couple of times. And then you bound this, the worst case error exponent over all possible different sets here, and that takes a form like this, and therefore you can overall bound the probability of error. Then you look for conditions on that. You also need to bound the cardinality of this epsilon x. So theta epsilon of s is the size of that. This mod theta epsilon of s is the size of an epsilon net on this set s, that is the set of all gammas with support s and non-zero entries bounded between gamma min and gamma max. But that epsilon net is computed with this log likelihood, a distance measure based on this log likelihood function. And so that requires you to compute the Lipschitz constant of this log likelihood to bound that. But if you put all of that together, this is a very sort of long proof, but if you put all of that together, you get the result I showed you in the previous slide. So there were two conditions. The first condition was that fee kathira of fee must satisfy an RIP property of order 2k. And so one question is, when will that condition hold? And if then we actually have a full-length journal paper on just this question itself. But this is just one result from that paper, which says that if phi has IID Gaussian zero mean unit variance entries, then this the kth restricted isometric constant of phi kathira of phi, there's the normalization by square root of n. Probability that this exceeds delta can be made to decrease polynomially in n. N is the number of columns in phi, with whatever power we like for any beta greater than 1, provided m is greater than or equal to beta to the 3 over 2 over delta times, here's the important part, square root of k times log n to the 3 over 2. Okay. So if you recall results on the when the matrix phi, or here it is, I'm going to use phi and a somewhat interchangeably, apologies for that, but if I look at just the matrix phi itself, and if I ask when will delta k of phi exceed some delta, I can make that go down polynomially in n, so n to the alpha, provided m is greater than k log n. Okay, that's the kind of result that's available for the matrix phi itself. But when I look at this matrix phi kathira of phi, I can make it satisfy the RIP condition for with m scaling as square root of log n to the 3 over 2. So this is the advantage of going through this SDL route, which makes us look at this phi kathira of phi as a sort of pseudo measurement matrix from which we're going to recover gamma and later use that to estimate x.
Isn't delta dependent on
the bound? Delta is here. There is no delta here. It comes in through this time. So you can see here also, these are the type of results. Here also this Foucault, this theorem says, 9.27, you can see that there is delta, it's 1 over n to the alpha, and then the delta comes in through the bound on m. Another question?
Yeah, we have signal results for matrices that are not Gaussian.
So, in fact, the result in this paper, it applies to all sub-Gaussian matrices. I'll skip this in the interest of time. It's based on variational characterization of this kth restricted isometric constant and the property of this Kathirov product. It's the Hadamard product of these two matrices, and then a series of Gaussian tail bounds and this Hansen-Wright inequality. Okay, so the implications are that if n is fixed, as long as the number of measurements scale as square root of k and the number of MMVs grows as k to the 3 over 2, I can get perfect support recovery. And this holds for k between 1 and, now it turns out that it depends on the crystal rank of, which is closely related to this spark that I mentioned earlier, of phi kathira of phi. And this crystal rank can be of the order n square, and that's why I can get successful recovery for k going all the way up to order n square. So now we are able to explain why this MSDL algorithm can give you successful support recovery for k going all the way up to order n square. So this is another way to put it. It has different conditions on. So this is actually directly taken from the paper, and that's why you see a here instead of p. I don't want to read out all of these, but what I want to say is that you can generate different types of cross dependencies between m, the number of measurements per sparse vector, and an l, that is the number of MMVs under which your recovery will be successful. This condition here corresponds to the case where the matrix A itself is 2k RIP compliant, and in that case, if your noiseless measurements, you just need one MMV, and if your noisy measurements, you need this kind of order, and if you have A which is random, so this could be a general A with unit norm columns. So for example, the random DFT matrix is an example of such a matrix. These are the kind of bounds on L that you need. So you get different bounds for different models on this T matrix. Now, so basically this analysis motivated us to come up with some new interesting algorithms for sparse signal recovery, which will help us address the second question of the fact that this EM algorithm is very slow. We looked at this, the cost function that the NSBL algorithm is trying to minimize, which is the negative log likelihood, a little more closely, and it's proportional to the log debt of sigma squared I plus phi gamma phi transpose, plus the trace of this matrix inverse times 1 over L YY transpose. Okay, and if you look at this form, log debt of this, there is one term missing here, which is the log debt of this matrix here, but that doesn't depend on gamma. And so, in terms of the cost function, its form is exactly identical to the log debt Bregman divergence between two matrices. And what are these two matrices? The first matrix is the empirical covariance matrix, that is the covariance matrix you compute from the observations. And the second matrix is the parametrized covariance matrix, the matrix you compute using the parametric model that we imposed on these sparse vectors. So that's what is said here. So the principle here is to find a gamma hat that minimizes the distance between the empirical covariance matrix and the parametrized covariance matrix. So then the question is, what distance measure should we use? We tried, instead of the log debt Bregman divergence, the alpha Reddy divergence, which basically is the distance between two distributions. If you take Gaussian distributions, this is the Gaussian distribution with covariance given by the empirical covariance matrix. The Gaussian distribution with the covariance given by the model, the hierarchical model that we use for the sparse vectors. And if you write out this thing, this is, you can write it out like this for the case of Gaussian distributions. It has this form here. And this form now can be then interpreted as covariance matching between these two covariance matrices. So for simplicity, we also assume that the non-zero entries of gamma have the same common but unknown variance, the small gamma here. Okay, and so if you do that, then this becomes a set function minimization problem, where you're looking for the subset S, which is a subset of 1 to n, which minimizes this cost function. Both these cost functions, or both these functions are submodular functions of the set S, and therefore it's a difference of two submodular functions. Then what can be done is to upper bound this first term by a modular function, which actually has a way, there's an efficient way of computing that upper bound using rank 1 updates. And then it becomes a difference of a modular function and a submodular function, which is supermodular. And so you can use greedy search to optimize it with some 1 by 1 plus e or something guarantee on its optimality. Nonetheless, the greedy optimization technique is very fast. Okay, so if I look at the performance of the algorithm inspired by this cost function, by the way, one other thing I want to mention is that when d equal to half, all of you probably know that this is exactly the Bhattacharya distance. So once again, we come back to some of the earlier talks today. So this is these are the phase transition diagrams. Kohl-Lasso is one other algorithm which is available in the literature, which what it does is it minimizes the Frobenius norm of the error between Ry and the parametrized covariance matrix plus an L1 penalty on gamma. Okay, that's what it does. And so this is the phase transition diagram of this Kohl-Lasso algorithm. This is MSBL and this is the algorithm I just talked to you about, RDCMP. So you can see that they all have similar phase transition behavior. So basically, all three algorithms are covariance matching based algorithms. So they have similar, very good performance. But if you look at the runtime for MSBL, this is Kohl-Lasso, and this is the RDCMP. Essentially, the point is that we are not able to run these two algorithms for more than 10 power 4 length vectors. So beyond that, MATLAB runs out of memory, and whereas this continues to function up until even a million dimensional vectors. So basically the thing is that we want to, in covariance matching, we want to find a non-negative diagonal gamma such that these two covariance matrices are actually equal to each other. And for such type of problems, when you want to minimize a function with, say, non-negativity constraints, This matrix exponentiated gradient based methods are actually very, very convenient. In fact, generally speaking, these exponentiated gradient based methods are sort of sometimes can be much faster. And the reason is because they there are different ways. So basically, when you have a non-negativity constraint, if you go outside the feasible set, you have to find a way to project back into the feasible set. And depending on how you choose to do it, your algorithm can actually convert much faster. And this is one way which has been, again, empirically found to work very well. And so one can actually use this use ideas from here with the logdet Breakman divergence to get this kind of an update. So this, as you can see, so recall that earlier I showed you the EM-based updates. There was a mu and a sigma that I had to compute and then update my gamma by as mu I squared plus sigma ii. This is a direct update of gamma I based on this matrix here. In fact, this can also be computed very efficiently. And so this is the update which is based on the matrix exponentiated gradient approach to minimizing the same cost function. There is a parameter here which is eta which has to be tuned, and that comes because we also include another the Frobenius norm of the difference between these two as an extra penalty term with an eta as its coefficient, and that is what is appearing here. So for this particular avatar of the algorithm, I need to tune this eta as well, but the point is this is an algorithm which shows considerable promise. You can see its phase transition diagram is very similar to the phase transition diagrams I showed you earlier. And therefore, the conclusion is that covariance matching is a powerful technique for sparsing recovery problems. And there are different ways of achieving covariance matching, and they could give us interesting new algorithms that can break the speed bottleneck of the associated with these EM-based updates. There was a slide here which said this is the conclusion of this talk, but they don't want me to conclude the talk. But let me just acknowledge my student Sora, whose work I presented today. We have many more interesting things. For example, Geetu has worked on temporally correlated sparse vector recovery, where you exploit the temporal correlation in the sparse vectors by incorporating this EM updates into a Kalman filtering framework. Ranjita actually is the first student in my group who started working on these sparse signal recovery problems and applying it to multiple antenna wireless channel estimation and data detection problems. Vinut now is a master's student who worked on sparse signal recovery under colored and ranked efficient covariance noise with colored noise with ranked efficient covariance matrix. So lots of work on this area. I only gave you a flavor of some of the work that Saurav has done. He has also wrote new algorithms on distributed sparse signal recovery, which I didn't talk about. So that concludes my talk. Thank you very much. So the boundary is, so now you can see this thing. It's actually showing. This was my conclusion slide, but the boundary comes from the fact that if you look at the successful recovery, it says that I will succeed whenever m is of the order square root of k, right? And so that is the boundary that you see there. But what is plotted is m by n and k by n, so you have to actually correctly scale that and plot it.
You have a prediction of what the curve is and how the curve.
Okay, so there are some constants there. There are some constants there that we need to figure out, but yeah, it's a good point that those constants can actually be computed, so it's a good point to actually include that curve into that phase transition diagram to show how it compares. So thank you very much.